Dark energy.
Okay. So the last time, yesterday, we have a look at the cosmological constant, problem, and from today, so today and tomorrow, we'll be devoted to assuming that the cosmological constant problem has been solved. So the cosmological constant, in the way that we talked about, is basically zero, and we will try to explain or make some attempt at explaining the accelerated expansion of the universe and the observations in terms of other things, okay, alternatives. It is fair to say that until now there is not really a compelling alternative, something that you can say, well, it's clearly this. Because it solves many problems. As I explained at the beginning, all the observations are consistent roughly with the cosmological constant. However, I think it's important to have alternatives, especially because in the future we will have a lot of new data. So it's nice also to compare the model that we have, the Lambda CDM, with alternatives. And also, it's nice to study new effects that could be just be neglected because we are looking at the data in a certain way. Okay. So since there is not a clear, compelling model, I will talk more about mechanisms and physical effects. I think it's important that you know these mechanisms if you want to study these sort of things and if you want to have an idea of what people talk when they, I don't know, for instance, talk about try to constrain gravity at cosmological scales and so on. Okay. So I will start with the simplest alternative, which is what has been called quintessence. And the idea basically is that we are replacing the cosmological constant with the dynamical scalar field. So the action of the scalar field coupled to gravity. So I'm assuming that there is the standard Einstein-Hilbert action plus scalar. So we write the full action like that. P of phi. And the scalar field has some potential, and clearly this is the kinetic term, and clearly the potential determines the dynamics. This is very similar to what you have already seen for inflation, right? So we can, I guess that you did that for inflation, we can extract the stress energy tensor from this action, right? And this is given by the new phi minus g mu nu 1 alpha d phi squared plus v of phi. Okay. And then, as you did for inflation, I'm going to assume that the scalar field in forced approximation is homogeneous. Okay, so I'm going to focus on the homogeneous solution. And well, it's easy to show that the energy density of the scalar field is minus the 0,0 component of the stress energy tensor. And what I find is that this is equal to 1 alpha phi dot squared plus. So 1 alpha the kinetic energy plus the potential energy. Okay. And then you do the same for the pressure, P of phi, and you find that this is equal to the kinetic energy minus the potential energy. And so the equation of state is the pressure. So is 1 alpha phi dot square minus phi of phi 1 half phi rho squared plus phi of phi. And this is all the, this clearly can be equal to minus 1 in the cosmological constant limit, so in the limit in which the scalar field is perfectly constant, okay? So when I can neglect the kinetic term. In the other cases, the equation of state parameter will be slightly less than more than minus 1. Okay. And in general, to have something accelerating close to minus 1, let's say, let's put it like that, we need phi dot square to be much smaller than the potential energy. So the kinetic energy is much smaller than the potential energy. This is not so dissimilar to what you have seen for inflation. Although in this case, there will not be only the scalar field contributing to the energy density of the universe, but there is also some dark matter component. But eventually, in the future, only the scalar field will dominate the universe. So at the level, maybe just to, yeah, at the level of observations, or let's say physical effects, what can we say? Let's suppose that W is a constant and that is slightly larger than minus 1. There is no reason to really take it as a constant. In general, there will be some dynamics. If I take the scalar field in a potential, there will be some dynamics, and I can study this just like you did for the slower case in inflation. But so what would you expect given that W is slightly larger than the one of a cosmological constant? Physically, what would have happened in the past? Can you? Come on, say something. Now, you remember that if I look at the energy density of a species as a function of the scale factor, you remember how the energy density of a species scale with the scale factor? You remember? Huh? A? 1 plus W, right? Okay, very good. Okay. So in the case of the cosmological constant is this one. Is a constant. If W is slightly larger than minus 1, I will have something that is dominating a little bit more than the cosmological constant in the past, right? Okay. And the effect will be, well, there will be, of course, an effect on the Q0 parameter that one can study. Another effect that we will have will be on cosmological perturbations, and in particular on the growth of the dark matter perturbations, because as we saw yesterday, we said that the cosmological constant was slowing down the growth of structures. So I expect that there will be slightly a more slowing down of this growth in the presence of a component which has a W larger than minus 1. Yes, larger than minus 1. So something like that, if you study these fluctuations, happens. So yesterday we draw this plot. We draw the growing mode. Take away this. So in fact, we show this equation, which by the way will be valid, will be still valid in this case. In this particular case, at least on smaller scales. We saw that in matter domination, delta grows like the scale factor for a cosmological constant. So for a CC, we have a slowing down, and if W is larger than minus 1, we will have even a larger slowing down, okay, something like that. So we will find that the structure are a little bit more damped than in the standard case. In general, this particular quintessence fluid does not cluster. I mean, in forced approximations, of course, there will be small fluctuations of the order of 10 to the minus 5, but it doesn't cluster at the level of having an energy density contrast, delta rho of the scalar field over rho field of order 1, okay? The density perturbations of the scalar field will be always small. And the reason is that if I look at the perturbation equations of this field, this is something like that. So if I expand, I take the evolution equation of the field, which is the Klein-Gordon equation, and I expand it at linear order in the Flick fluctuations, this equation looks like this. So these are the field perturbations. I am assuming now I'm adding perturbation here. Okay. So they will have a pressure gradient term, which in this case corresponds to having a speed of fluctuation of the scalar field equal to 1. Okay, because I'm taking a relativistic scalar field. And so exactly as you saw with Blake, when you have this pressure gradient term, your species, okay, it will be damped by the Hubble friction, but it will also display oscillations, okay? And so when you go to short scales, by the way, here there will be corrections induced by the metric perturbations. When you go to short scales or to large scales, the typical behavior will be that these perturbations will oscillate but will remain small, and eventually they will be damped by the expansion, by the presence of this Hubble friction term, okay? So the scalar field perturbations do not grow in general, in this case, okay? Good. Okay, there are, just to anticipate, there are two cases where these perturbations could grow. One is when there are no pressure gradients, and so CS is much smaller than 1. And the other one is when here there is a source, a gravitational source, which contains many more gradients. And or there is a direct coupling, say direct coupling with matter, for instance. Okay. In this case, the perturbations of this dark energy component will grow. But in this case, you talk about modified gravity more than quintessence. Question, yeah.
I didn't understand why W greater than minus 1 will further suppress the growth, because W equals to 0, for instance, will be in dark matter, will behave like dark matter, and therefore will be a straight line.
Exactly, so very good point. Why does not behave like dark matter? I mean, the homogeneous part, yes. Is true what you say.
The lecturer is required to repeat the question.
Sorry, yes. So the question was, I said that if W is larger than minus 1, perturbations are more suppressed with respect to the lambda CDM case, with respect to the case of the cosmological constant. This is in contrast with what we know, for instance, in the case of dark matter, where W is equal to 0. And we have an and perturbation grow like the scale factor, right? This is roughly. But look at this equation. So the fact that the fluctuations in the dark matter case grow is due to the dark matter component, right? Is due to the fact that the speed, this CS square here is zero. Okay, so there is no counterbalance to the gravitational force. There is no pressure. There are no pressure gradients, and therefore you have a growth of fluctuations. Here we are looking at something different. We are looking at the effect of the dark energy perturbations on the dark matter ones. Okay, so if I go back in the past, and W is less is larger than minus one, so I'm in this quintessence case, I will have less dark matter and more cosmological constant, and so I will slow down more the growth. Okay, just because I'm reducing the component that can cluster. Okay. Okay. Good. Okay. Let us see some shortcomings of quintessence. So as you see, I'm not talking about specific models. I'm not discussing some specific models. I will discuss a particular model in a second. As we said, phi dot squared must be much smaller than the potential. So the kinetic energy must be much smaller than the potential. If the scalar field is slow rolling, you remember that this is the condition for slow roll. And in this case, I can look at the variation of the scalar field in a Hubble time. Okay, so let's say delta phi in a Hubble time. This will be given by h minus 1, roughly speaking, times phi dot. And so now if I use this slow roll condition here, I will have that this is roughly v prime over h squared. V prime, well, assume that v is a slow, is a monomial potential, is some phi to some exponent n. Okay, so in this case, v prime can be written like v over phi. And I see that the relative change in the scalar field in a Hubble time will be of the order of V, the potential, but you know, the potential, quintessence is dominating the universe, so the potential will be roughly h squared. If I use the Friedmann equation, this will be of the order of 8 pi g3 times the potential, because the energy density of the scalar field is dominated by the potential. And so I can write here 8 pi g, okay, h squared, phi squared. So h squared simplifies. And I can define 1 over 8 pi g as Planck mass squared, so that I can write this as Planck mass over phi. So if I want my scalar field to vary less than the typical value of this scalar field in a Hubble time, and this is typically what I would like to see if I don't want big changes in the equation of state, so sizable changes that are already ruled out in the equation of state, then you see from this relation that the phi should be larger than the Planck mass. So I have what are called trans-Planckian changes in the field, or super-Planckian, let's say, field variation. Sorry, field variation. The value of phi must be larger than the Planck mass. Have you seen this in inflation? Did you discuss about that? Blank. No. Okay. Well. Okay. So, in principle, there is no theorem forbidding that. Although it seems difficult in concrete models to realize. To have this in mind. For instance, in string theory, it seems difficult to have a phi much larger than the Planck mass. A manifestation of this that has become fashionable or discussed a lot since a few years is the Swampland conjectures that you have probably heard about. The first of this conjecture that has been applied to inflation and also to quintessence tells you that the first derivative of the potential of the scalar field should be larger than the potential itself divided by Planck mass. And this is exactly in string theory. And this is exactly the same as saying that phi should be smaller than the Planck mass, because it's exactly the opposite of what I showed you here, if you want smaller variations. Yes.
Yes, so two things. So first of all, maybe you don't know, but the Vafa gave a lecture about the Swampland on Tuesday, although he didn't enter too much into detail, so I'm not even sure if he mentioned this, but anyway, just to say
that. Very good.
Another thing from the audience, from the Zoom, I think phi dot square is very... it's very bigger than zero, not V. Sorry.
Phi dot square is much bigger than zero. No, sorry.
No, I think I think the answer is no. It's much smaller than V.
It's also bigger than zero. But
let's see if maybe he writes again.
Okay, very good. Okay. Okay. Well, ma the camera. But I think you can say decline. Sorry. Okay. So this is the first thing that I wanted to say. The second thing is the following. Can you see now? Okay. If you look at by using this equation, if you imagine that this potential is simply a m square phi square potential, so the scalar field has a mass, as you have probably seen in inflation. So in this case, this is H0 squared today. So I'm using this equation. Here I put m squared phi squared. I rewrite 8 pi g as m plus square. And I find that since phi must be larger than the Planck mass, I find that the mass of the scalar field, of the quintessence field, must be much smaller than the Hubble ray today, which is 10 to the minus 33 electron volt. So this is a super light field. And well, let's say yesterday we look at the quantum correction to the cosmological constant, also quintessence if it is coupled to other fields, not only standard model fields but maybe other fields that we haven't seen yet would receive huge corrections, and so it would be difficult to understand the smallness of this mass. Okay. The same if I put a lambda to the 4 coupling, I can do the same calculation, and I find that lambda must be much smaller than 10 to the minus 120. So it's a very strange uncoupled, very weakly coupled field, let's say. Okay. So it seems to be to have a very unnatural potential. Except, as someone mentioned yesterday, except if we impose some symmetry on this scalar field. For instance, the typical example is if the scalar field is a pseudo Nambu Goldstone boson. In this case, you know that the potential. The potential is something like that, and because in the limit where a Goldstone boson is a field which is massless, so where which realizes shift symmetry. Okay, a pseudo Nambu Goldstone boson is the same, except that you are softly breaking this shift symmetry, and therefore the correction to the mass of this scalar field can be controlled and can be made as small as you want, if you want, in a naturally natural way. Okay. In this case, however, just as what we discussed before. If you want the mass of the scalar field to be small, you also need F. You need F to be much larger than the Planck mass, because you want phi to be larger than the Planck mass. And again, this seems to be difficult to achieve with concrete models. Okay, I think now I have to make a choice. Do you prefer that I talk about tracking fields or dark energy perturbations? Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Why silver?
Well, because in this case there would be no mass. It would be perfectly shift symmetric, a Goldstone boson, right? Sorry?
Is there a symmetry being broken?
There is a symmetry which is softly broken, like the axion in QCD, for instance. If it was a Goldstone boson, it would have only derivative couplings. It would not have a potential, because it should satisfy the symmetry, the shift symmetry. So you would expect the Lagrangian to contain only terms like d phi square or d phi to the fourth, etc. So what do you prefer? No, it's difficult.
It's a difficult question.
Yeah, I know. You prefer the cluster and perturbation. Okay. Anyone? Now, okay, let's talk about that. So we mentioned, in fact, it's connected to this. So let's clustering quintessence. And in the notes, you will also have the tracking field. So we said earlier that this is the equation satisfied by perturbation of the scalar field, C squared K squared delta phi equal to metric perturbations, and that the value of this speed of fluctuations of the scalar field is crucial to determine whether it's clustering or not. Okay. So let's take a Lagrangian, which is so now I'm just considering the scalar field Lagrangian, and I will assume that it's a function. I don't specify it yet, but we can specify it of phi, the scalar field, and x, where x is this, okay? Sometimes this is called the k-essence. And if it's used in inflation, it's called the k-inflation. Okay? And if it's used in mechanics, it's called k-mechanics. No. So you can write down a stress energy tensor also in this case, and you can write it like that. Plus P, sorry, capital P G mu. And you can interpret this as the stress energy tensor of a scalar field, of a perfect fluid, which is this one. Okay, if you identify capital P, which is the Lagrangian, with the pressure, and then you have to identify, so the pressure is capital P, and the energy density is 2 pi comma x. When I say comma x, it means derivative, so derivative with respect to x of P, okay, minus P. And finally, U mu, so the four velocity of the fluid is this one. So from here you can reconstruct the equation of state as we did before by taking this divided by this. But you have an extra freedom. Now, if I expand my scalar field in perturbations around the background like I did before, and now I also, well, expand x around minus phi dot squared, I'm going to find let me give you directly I'll do it. So I'm going to find this expression. So this is the background value of the first derivative of P with respect to x, and then I will have a kinetic term for perturbation like that. And then I have a term which is absent in the case of a standard quintessence field, which is this one, and then other terms without derivatives. Okay. And you see that now, so the usually in the standard quintessence case, so standard quintessence case is p is equal to x, 1/2 x, so minus 1/2 x minus v of phi, right? So the second derivative of p with respect to x is zero, and I find an harmonic oscillator with oscillations propagating at the speed of light. Okay, here there is one. However, in this case, I find that the speed of fluctuations will be given by what is in front of here, which is p of x, divided by what is in front of the time kinetic term, which is p of x plus x2x p of xx, which is this term here. Okay. So in the limit where x, pxx, is much larger than p of x, c squared is much smaller than 1. And now my dark energy field can really cluster. Okay. And what can happen in particular when CS is of the order of 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 7. So when the sound horizon of these fluctuations are smaller than a few megaparsec or something like that, is that you really see that the dark energy field clusters along with dark matter and contributes to the structure formation together with dark matter. Okay, there are people who are building simulations to try to simulate that and so on. So you can treat also this possibility. Questions about this? Yeah.
Small technical note, the form velocity identification with the gradient, that should be with upper indices. Because if I take the norm, then
this one?
Minus one. Yeah, and with upper indices, should I write it?
Well, but it's the same, no?
No, it's not.
Why not?
Because if we normalize it as this, then.
It's the same. Maybe the only thing that I would say is that I should put a minus to be future directed, but otherwise it's the same.
Yeah, but inverse metric, inverse metric is minus. Okay, it's fine.
I think it's fine.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So can that explain Hubble tension?
So, no, I think not. So I don't remember exactly the formula, but so I know that the dark energy fluctuations are suppressed with respect to the dark matter ones. Paolo, do you remember the formula for dark energy fluctuations when the speed of the sound is zero? No. Anyway, it will have the size of the dark matter fluctuations, but with an extra suppression that I think, that I don't remember, but I should check. 1 plus W. I don't know if it was this. So at the end, okay, depending on W, you have some sizable perturbation, but not something dramatic that could explain, yes. In any case, I don't see why it should go in that direction of explaining the zero tension. And also, this perturbation grow very at very late time, as we heard this morning, we would like more to look for a solution at early time. So, yeah. So it would, okay, it's okay. Okay, now let me enter in a new area. So now I will start. So until now I consider a scalar field which is decoupled from standard particles from the standard model. But let us start looking at coupling two matter. Or if you want, I will start introducing scalar tensor theories. Okay, so the possibility that this scalar field modifies gravity, mixes with gravity, modifying the standard gravitational dynamics. So we would like to study if the scalar field can be coupled to matter. If it is coupled to matter, it would be safer that it couples to matter in the same way because we have very tight constraints on the equivalence principle. And we know that, so we have seen that the scalar fields typically are very light. And you know that the light scalar field exchanges a fifth force. If you don't know it, you will see it very soon. And so in order for objects to fall in the same way, we would like all the objects to couple in the same way to this scalar field. Okay. So there is a traditional way of introducing this scalar tensor theories, which is the following. So to couple to put a function of the scalar field in front of the Ricci scalar, and then to write the action for a scalar field like the one that I showed you before. Okay. At the same time, I can add the action of some matter component that I assume to be minimally coupled to gravity. So to couple, I assume that matter, whatever it is, it couples to the gravitational metric that I'm using here. Okay. So it seems that the scalar field does not couple to matter in this case, right? I have just put it in this gravitational action. I can derive the generalized Einstein's equation in this case by varying this action with respect to the metric. So if I vary S with respect to G mu nu, then I'm going to obtain some modified Einstein's equation that you are invited to check in one of the exercises. So the left-hand side of the Einstein's equation is clearly modified. Instead of having the Einstein tensor, you have the Einstein tensor times a function of phi. And then some terms that depend on the second derivative of the scalar field.
Okay. Sorry, there is a question from Zoom.
Yeah.
Why can't the scalar field couple to matter field?
In this case.
Could you just kind of explain once more?
So for the moment, it seems that it doesn't couple, but you will see that, in fact, I can choose a different metric. I don't know where to look. I can choose a different metric to describe my system, and in this metric, you will see that there is a direct coupling of the scalar field to...
The camera is taking you from somewhere else.
So they look at the blackboard. Yes. So in this case, there is no direct coupling between the scalar field and matter. On the other hand, I'm using a gravitational field or a gravitational metric, which does not satisfy the usual Einstein equation. And therefore, at the end, you have a coupling between matter and the scalar field. In fact, it depends on the frame. It's called frame that you use to Filippo, describe your system.
Sorry, there is another question from the same person. Does a direct coupling violate the equivalent principle somehow?
Yeah. So. Let me maybe answer that later, because it's something that I partially said. But okay, when matter couples minimally to the metric, okay, we say that we are in the Jordan frame. Okay. But I can change the frame. And I put a frame in what's the name of in quotation marks, because it's not really a frame, but it's a choice of a field to describe the gravitational field. So I can go in the so-called Einstein frame. By making a field redefinition, which you can find out yourself by using if you go to Waltz. So the Waltz book on general relativity, your book, and you look to appendix D. Wald tell you how the Ricci curvature scalar changes under such a field redefinition, or such a conformal transformation, it's called. Okay. So the Ricci scalar written as a function of a metric, a tilde metric G mu nu, will be given by some Ricci scalar written in terms of the metric G mu nu without a tilde. And then there will be some factor of omega, which is, by the way, omega will be a function of the scalar field here, with derivatives of omega. Log omega minus 6 de mu log omega de mu log omega. Okay. And if you do a convenient choice, which is to choose omega squared equal to f minus 1, where f is exactly this function, you see that I can go to a form where the action is written like this. So now I'm using the Einstein frame metric. And let's say, roughly speaking, the scalar field will have the scalar field action will have the standard form P of phi Einstein, but matter of course, will be coupled to a metric chi mu nu Einstein and the scalar field. Okay. So just to be clearer, this is the transformation that I'm using here. So when we speak about frames, it's a bit of a misnomer, because in fact what we are doing is just a field redefinition. Okay, we are just describing the gravitational degree of freedom either with the G mu nu or with G mu nu Einstein in Einstein frame. And depending on the frame where we are, we can say that in Jordan frame, matter couples only to the gravitational metric, but the laws of gravities are modified. And in Einstein frame, the laws of gravity are the same, but matter couples directly to the scalar field. Okay? You see. So at the end, observables must be the same, independently of the frame where you look at them. But you can have a different description. Any question?
Yes, there is a question. Will field definition not cause problems with quantum loops and renormalization of one action compared to another?
No. So as long as the field definition is invertible, the physical description is exactly the same. And so then, of course, it may be more convenient to use one field, one metric with respect to the other, just for particle computations. For instance, in general, in cosmology, most of the observations that we make, we can say that they are made in the Jordan frame. Okay. The reason being that in the Jordan frame, test particles follow geodesics, and this is what we are used to when we make observations. And while, for instance, in Einstein frame, it's true that gravity is the same, but masses seem to be varying with the scalar field, so the interpretation it's a bit more difficult. But in principle, the two descriptions are absolutely the same as long as the field redefinition is invertible. Yes.
I think my question is related.
Yeah.
Why?
Why so? Because
matter is coupled also to the scalar field, so it will respond to the scalar field as well, not only to the gravity.
Well, as long as I consider test particles, they are coupled in the same way to the scalar field, so they will behave exactly in the same way. If I take one apple and one pear, I don't know. Now, two different objects. As long as I neglect the self-gravitational, the self-gravity of the object, so I'm in the test particle limit, in fact, they will fall exactly in the same way.
But in general,
in general, not, and this is due to the fact that that it's only in GR that once you include the gravitational self-coupling, objects fall exactly in the same way. In this particular theories, but this goes a bit beyond, in these theories, the non-linearities of, the self-couplings of the scalar field, if you want, the gravitational self-coupling of the scalar field will induce, strong equivalence principle violations. And that could be observed, but they would be more observed for for compact objects like black holes or stars or things like that. Then on small objects on Earth. Okay. So if I consider only test particles, these test particles satisfy the weak equivalence principle. So we are assuming that they do, in fact. In fact, we could break this assumption and we could say, well, there is not a single Jordan frame. Suppose, for instance, that there are two quotation mark Jordan frames, one for dark matter and one for standard model. And the standard model and dark matter particles are uncoupled. Then, well, as long as we look at the standard model, we will not see equivalence principle violation, but we could observe them by looking at, I don't know, halos of dark matter or things like that. But which is exactly what Maria showed yesterday. She was considering a model where dark matter is coupled to dark energy, but not the rest of the standard model, I think. No, yeah, exactly. So this would be an example of different coupling to matter. But still, since we observe only in lab, we look at the fall of objects of standard matter, we will not see EP violation. So as long as you consider test particles, it's fine. But then when you start looking at, this is why it's so interesting to look at the strong field regime of objects, like for instance, black holes or things like that. Okay, so one comment is the one that I just mentioned. Then let us look a bit at the phenomenon, at these two different descriptions, and the physical, the various physical effects that we could have. So as we said, so there is the Einstein frame. And in Einstein frame, gravity is standard. However, particles do not follow geodesics. So for instance, well, here I write down the conservation equation for the stress energy tensor of matter in Einstein frame. And this would be sourced by, would have a, well, in Einstein frame has a source term that depends on the scalar field and the coupling to the trace of the stress energy tensor, okay? And also the scalar field, instead of having the standard Clyde-Gordon equation, will have a coupling like that. Okay. So in Jordan frame, these couplings are not there, but gravity is modified. In Einstein frame, there are these couplings, and gravity is the same as GR. Okay. So as you see, the scalar field couples to the trace of the stress energy tensor. Okay, well, maybe the only thing, so this factor of A prime over A appears so many times that you want to define a parameter that I will call beta at the moment. Okay, and in Jordan frame, matter follows geodesics. Let's write it here. So in Jordan frame, we have the mu t mu nu equal to zero. The Einstein's equation have been written before, and the Klein-Gordon equation is modified because the scalar field mixes with gravity. So we have three main effects. One is the presence of a fifth force. So if I write the geodesic equation in the Jordan frame, I find xi dot dot plus gamma 0, 0i, where gamma is the Christoffel symbol with the 0, 0 lower indices. And let me be in the non-relativistic approximation. Okay. So I use a metric ds squared equal to minus 1 plus 2 phi dt squared plus a squared t 1 minus 2 psi dx squared. Okay. So this equation would give me something like that. Which looks like Newton's law, standard Newton's law. Oops. However, phi does not satisfy the usual gravitational equation. So for instance, it does not satisfy the Poisson equation, the usual Poisson equation. What satisfies the Poisson equation is phi in Einstein frame, okay? Because it's only in the Einstein frame that gravity is a standard. Okay. So in fact, I can write this geodesic equation as a phi in the Einstein frame minus beta, which is the parameter that I introduced before, in the Jordan frame. I can find this equation by using, if you want, by using the geodesic equation in Einstein frame, okay? Which tells me that phi in Einstein frame is equal to phi in Jordan frame. Well, let me write the opposite, the other way around, plus beta phi. And now I write down my Poisson equation, but using the Einstein frame metric. And I assume that there is a static source of mass m here. Static source of mass m, the solution of the Poisson equation will be that phi in the Einstein frame is equal to minus gm over r, so standard Newtonian potential. On the other hand, now I would like to I found the profile of phi in the presence of a static source of phi in the Einstein frame. Now I want to find what the solution of small phi is, so the scalar field is in the presence of a static source, and then reconstruct phi in Jordan frame, because it's the one that I observe, for instance, in a galaxy clustering or on the Lasswell structure, typically. So my scalar field satisfies the Klein-Gordon equation, as we said before. And as we said, it couples directly to matter. As you remember, in the scalar field as a source term due to matter. So this is a delta function, and the solution of this equation is that the scalar field it's a 4 pi r, and then there will be some Yukawa suppression if the scalar field is has a mass. Okay. So as you see, the fifth force is attractive. There is the same minus sign in front of the gravitational force. It can be suppressed if the scalar field is a mass. Let's assume that the mass of phi is of order h zero, so the Hubble rate today. In this case, I'm going to combine this here with this, and I find that phi is equal to minus one plus two. I'm going to write it like that, gr, where I define alpha. Alpha is a dimensionless quantity. Sorry for defining so many. Okay. So my Newtonian potential is enhanced by the effect of a fifth force, by something which is always positive, because there is a beta here and a beta here. So this gives me a beta squared, and then I just rewrite this beta in terms of alpha, which is dimensionless. So I want to define some dimensionless quantity. Okay. So of course, if I had kept my mass, then I would have had some modification of gravity, which are scale dependent, if you want, because I would have a dependence of r in here. Okay, then the second effect. The second effect that I have is that, in general, in these modified gravity theories, the two potentials, so the potential that enters in the G0, component of the metric, and the one that enters in the GIJ, in the special component of the metric, are not the same. And in GR, they are in the absence of stress energy stresses in the energy momentum tensor of matter. This can be seen quite easily so if I take, if I consider the conformal transformation between the Jordan frame metric and the Einstein frame metric, and I perturb it by using these expressions, I will find this equation that we already found. So I will find that phi is equal to phi Einstein plus beta phi from the G00 component, okay? And if I take the GIJ component and I look at the perturbations, I find the relation between the psi in the Jordan frame and psi in the Einstein frame. And in the case of psi, there is a minus psi for.
Filippo, let me ask a question from Zoom.
Yeah.
Could you please repeat the argument that allows you to neglect the Yukawa suppression and to put the mass of the scalar field over the Hubble?
Yeah, so in general, in general, it is not the case that I can suppress this mass. However, I would like to find a model where I have sizable effects on large scales. So in this case, I need to set a mass of the scalar field which is small. So I will consider this case from now on, just to be more specific. But of course, I could keep and I could study the scale dependence of this model in principle. Okay, so if you look at the relation between the Jordan frame metric potentials and the Einstein frame metric potentials, by knowing that in the Einstein frame these two are the same, because I'm assuming GR, I see that I see that phi is equal to psi minus 2 beta phi. Sorry, plus 2 beta phi. Okay. And I can also find the psi from here. And I see that the psi, I write it here, is equal to minus 1 minus 2 alpha squared gm over r.
Another question from Zoom. In Einstein's frame, why is psi equal to phi? Could you please say it once more?
Yeah, this is what, if you take Einstein's equation, g mu nu equal to 8 pi g t mu nu, you take g I j components, and you take in particular the traceless part of these GIJ components, and and you assume that there are no anisotropic stresses, you will find this equation, Laplacian of phi minus psi in Einstein frame equal to zero. Okay. Or in general, is this equation equal to anisotropic stresses? Okay. And if there are no anisotropic stresses, phi and psi are the same. And in fact, you have an exercise at the end of these lectures where you are invited to work with this equation in the non-relativistic approximation, and you see that. Well, I wrote down the components of the Einstein tensor in the non-relativistic approximation, and you see that these are given by this expression. Okay. In fact, what you really find is this equation here. Di dj minus 1/3 delta j Laplacian. Okay. To be more specific. Okay. Okay, the third effect that you have is that in general, G Newton can depend on time. But this you may have expected it because you remember that in my Einstein equation, I had in Jordan frame a decoupling, FIR, no, in the action in Jordan frame, I replaced so in GR the Einstein Hilbert term is the Ricci tensor divided by 16 pi g, and in this theory, this 1 over 16 pi g is replaced by a function of phi, and if phi varies in time, of course also your g can vary in time, okay? So in general, this is given by 2a prime over a, so 2 beta phi dot. So if I depends on time, also the Newton constant depends on time, which of course is something that is constrained. Okay. Then I can stop
it's
here.
It's true, no?
So, No, it's true, yes. Okay. So next time I will show you, I will quickly show you what are the constraints that you have on these theories, and then we will talk about a way to avoid these constraints on short scales, on solar system scales, while maintaining possibilities of modifying gravity on various scales.
So given that there is the discussion session soon after the coffee break, maybe I would postpone the questions to that. Okay, we're back in half an hour.